What were your thoughts watching that Western Conference Finals game last night? Steve Kerr was flat out asked by a member of the media if Curry was hurt and how much his injury is affecting his play. And Kerr put his tongue in cheek and gave a percentage from the draft lottery. What do you think?
I'm not so sure I'm going to call him hurt, because didn't he look pretty good against the Pelicans? So, I mean, did something happen in practice in the time in between? This is the time where NBA players have to manage their bodies over the course of regular season to perform at their best in the playoffs. And I understand that he had an injury, not a wear and tear injury, but you know, if he's on the court, that's, you know, the old maxim: if you're playing, you're not injured. And you know, is the injury causing him to start the game 0-for-6 from three? To me, you know, the Rockets just took it to the Warriors. I got to give credit to Mike D'Antoni for not doing any drastic lineup changes or not really going away from what they worked. He figured that Eric Gordon's due, P.J. Tucker's due, Trevor Ariza's due, and James Harden's going to be the same brilliant guy he always is. And they looked like a very formidable team that's going to give the Warriors trouble through the rest of this series, the way they played last night.
All right. And then as for the Eastern Conference Finals, what's Ty Lue to do? I mean, he went to Tristan Thompson. We did see a lot of the players that they got in the Lakers trade. Rodney Hood as well. It seems like he might be out of bullets here, Dave. What do you think going into game four?
It looks a little bleak, other than the fact that you had to remember that the Celtics are still so young and they're 1-4 on the road in these playoffs. The Cavs play well at the Q. They have a real home court advantage, and LeBron was getting anything he wanted until he got, you know, unfortunately shouldered in the face by Jason Tatum, unintentional, of course. But that affected his play in game two. You know, Ty Lue claims he's going to stick with Rodney Hood. He went away from Jordan Clarkson in game two. You know, again, there aren't many bullets there. He has to play these guys that he trusts and know that can contribute on both ends. So that means J.R. Smith, even though he's going 0-for-7, you're not going to pull him for a guy like Jordan Clarkson, because J.R. Smith knows the defensive schemes. He can get hot. And you know, Ty's kind of stuck with the hand he has here to play, and he has to think about, hey, JR shot 77% against the Raptors in the Eastern Conference semifinals. That's bound to come back around for him. I do think you'll see more Tristan Thompson, because the word that Ty used after game two was the Celtics were gooning up the game, and Tristan Thompson's the most physical player for the Cavs. So I think you're going to see more Tristan Thompson and potentially even some more Larry Nance. And Ty doesn't like to play a three-center rotation. That would be obviously Kevin Love and Tristan and Larry Nance Jr. But I think that's going to be his best course of action in terms of getting guys who play with automatic physicality out there on the court.
What do you mean by gooning up the game? I mean, wasn't it J.R. Smith who shoved Al Horford in the back towards the end of a game that was already decided?
Yeah, it was an interesting choice of verbiage by Ty Lue. Of course, his player is the one that was called out by Marcus Smart for being dirty, and rightfully so. That was a play that has no business on a basketball court. It's dangerous. I was a little surprised, considering J.R. Smith's previous history with these type of things, that he wasn't suspended for Game 3. I guess Joe Borgia, the head of NBA officials, said that Al Horford wasn't hurt. So do you need to hurt a guy to get a suspension now? I'm not so sure, but I think Ty, I'm not really sure that he meant it in a dirty connotation, other than the fact that they are setting the tone for physicality and what is allowed and what will be called and what won't be called out there on the court. He wants his team to do that same thing and bring that physicality from the start. And that's why you're going to see him sticking with Tristan Thompson, sticking with a guy like J.R. Smith. J.R. Smith, even though he had his problems in game two, both shooting the ball and embarrassing the game, he is their most physical wing defender.
Yeah, I mean, that is an interesting point. Dave McManaman of ESPN joining us here is that, you know, if Horford had broken his arm, does that mean J.R. Smith would have been suspended for as long as Horford would have been out? I mean, isn't that the flip side of that whole argument?
Yeah, and the TNT broadcast crew last night was talking about a play where Ariza was bringing up the court and Draymond Green two-arm shove into him, and they said, you know, what if that was Chris Paul, you know, bringing the ball up the court, and he actually takes the same shove, but because he's a smaller player, he goes flying into the crowd. Is it a different call? You know, these things are tough to call. I don't think the standard should be injury, though, or the standard should be how far a player is thrown. I think if you're an airborne player who's defenseless, that should be a pretty easy call. Now, I'm not so sure I would have been in favor of suspension. I think he should have been thrown out of game two. But when you get it wrong initially, then you have to kind of make up for it. And I am a little surprised he wasn't suspended.
The Rich Eisen Show, weekdays at noon Eastern on Audience.